February 11th, the Conway Grammar School Committee, and we have a forum this evening, just three of us. I think we'll pass on introductions now. Everybody knows everybody by now. Okay, so I guess we can first review and approve the minutes of January 11th. Do we have a motion to accept the minutes?
Motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Very well done.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, that was easy. Financial statements?
Could you put that with the warrants?
She just gave it to me.
Who?
Jan, so that I could write down the amount.
No, I have it.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so tonight you have seven warrants totaling $41,007.11 to sign. And other than that, we're right on target. We're doing well with our budget.
Are you saving money on oil?
Yes, we
the
are.
The warm winter we've had still?
Yes, we are.
All that's about to change though, right?
And
well,
I
only
did,
for 2 days. It's supposed to rain next week.
Yeah,
did great. I report to you last month that I did lock in next year's prices as well?
At these rates?
Yes.
No way!
Yes.
Who would do that? That is silly!
They all offered.
I need to sign that up!
Or pro oil.
Yeah.
They offered, I
forget
said...
solar panels.
Sure.
Wow. That's crazy.
So that's all I have under the financial report, unless anybody has any questions.
No questions here.
No.
Okay, do an update on building or building?
The only thing I had, last month we had asked Bob Lesko to find out about the garage doors, and you had voted that if it was less than 2,000 to go ahead. He doesn't have those figures yet. And I don't know, Judy, if you were gonna check on the flooring for the wings, if that was something that we, it, remember
the
when
carpeting,
back,
yeah.
Yeah, if we wanted carpeting or go to linoleum or
yes.
What, so.
It was more of a tepid response. I can
a
check
tepid
response,
okay. All right.
So it looks like those doors will probably be able to fit into this year's budget, right? Is that what you're thinking?
The
yes.
Current budget,
yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
But now that you say that something is ringing, Mr. Lesko did come into my office to tell me that Mr. Jouinette told him something about some problem.
Well, I heard we had a leaking roof again.
No,
okay.
Don't even say that.
In the gymnasium.
Okay, that was
right?
It.
Right? Was, yeah. Was this the problem?
Yes.
The other problems that he might have mentioned have to do with the furnace, but they're all manageable under this year's budget.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I don't know what the resolution was to the leaking roof. Did
Bob was supposed to contact the company.
Okay.
How can that still be happening?
Jamrog? Is it not Jamrog?
No, the roofer.
The roofer.
The roofer. Oh.
Giant Corp. Giant Roofing Corp.
And company.
Yeah. And son.
Was this recent, Judy? The leak?
Yeah.
Okay.
About a month ago, I'd say, right?
I don't think it was a month. I would say it was, I mean, with February 11th, I would say it happened in January.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
It happened 2 weekends in succession.
I was very disheartened to hear that.
Oh, that's awful.
We just can't get rid of these leaks.
Yeah, that is disheartening to hear. Okay.
Time to retire.
Well, almost 50%
that should
of
be your answer to everything, the two of you. More than 50% we're talking about. Two-thirds of these people here are retiring on me.
So Bob was going to call the roofing company?
Yes, he was.
Okay. All right.
Don't tell people at town meeting. Cut that out.
Actually, there may be a warranty of some type. That's within...
I was going to say, that has to be...
That's within
yeah.
A certain...
Mm-hmm.
I don't... There is warranties on the...
Oh, totally.
20. I don't know what the warranty is. I don't want to say.
Well, it depends what the issue is, you know? Is it... I don't know. Hopefully we'll get something that's not so bad to hear back.
Well, I wasn't... Mr. Lesko didn't feel it was as bad as Mr. Jouinette thought it was. In Bob's assessment, he didn't feel it was as crucial as Mr. Joynette thought it was.
Well, I heard from parents who are in the basketball court that they were lining up buckets collecting water.
Well, that is not good.
No. That is not good.
All right.
Yeah, a drip is one thing. Buckets are another.
Yeah, on the gym floor.
A small structural issue.
We can fix it.
Yes,
we need to fix it.
There's little drops and there's big drips.
So that being said, are we need to probably formalize a request to the select board for our stabilization money. Mm-hmm. I know they're holding a spot for us. And we don't have that as a vote on the agenda. I guess we'll have to do it next time, but.
We can have a vote even though it's not listed on the agenda.
Okay.
Yeah, we have done that. We do that.
I think we should do that. I think we were all feeling pretty much the same thing, that we should go ahead and ask for stabilization money again in the same amount, the $50,000. And that's always up for discussion by the Finance Committee.
And reduction.
It may not be the final amount, but we can at least ask for what we think is reasonable.
So do you want to do that?
I make a motion.
Second. All in favor?
I'm sorry, you said 50,000?
Yes.
Okay.
And I know when the discussion has come up, one of the things that goes in our favor, I think, is that we used part of that for the septic.
No, we didn't.
We didn't?
No.
Oh?
No, you can't just use it. It actually has to be voted out in town meeting.
Oh, I thought that septic would have been a good usage.
We actually had...
we had enough money in the budget left over. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. No, to use stabilization money, it takes a two-thirds vote by the town people.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you, it's good to do because Deerfield was doing that, and we were able to use that money for the startup for the MSBA project that we're doing there with their roof. So if we're going to be doing a heating project here that we put in for MSBA funding, that could be our startup money.
Mm-hmm.
For the schematic and design phase, which is what we were doing in Deerfield. So it's a good idea.
Okay. Okay, and then, so I guess, boy, this is going to go quick. So report by me, and I guess I will just tell you, like the rest of you, I've been going to a lot of meetings this past week or two, maybe more than that. And our principal search is going very well. The committee met with Judy this morning, and she gave us some very valuable insights to what she felt was important and characteristics to look for.
Mm-hmm.
And so we've collected 26 resumes, is it? It was 20-something.
25.
25 resumes, and we're going to be scoring them over vacation. We're beginning to score them because they're still coming in up until the 19th. And so the 22nd, we're going to put our scores together and decide who's going to be interviewed. And then following on the 29th, we should be starting interviews.
Yeah, and resumes are all held at central office, so committee members have to go to the office to review them.
Yeah.
So they're not floating out and about.
Right. So we have a really, really vigorous process going. I'm very impressed by the way things are going. We also, we had a parent forum on Wednesday night, brought in a small crowd of five or six people, but it offered some very valuable feedback and conversation. So.
I thought it was good anybody showed up, so.
Yeah.
Jan and I were there.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I heard that, you know, Louise said the conversation was very valuable, so even though it was a small number,
mm-hmm.
It is. It's, you know, people are busy. It's hard to get people out, especially on cold, snowy nights.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was good that we had that many.
Yeah. And another thing I wanted to tell you is that the town caucus is coming up March 7th, and there are two people who are up for re-election. One is not here.
Am I?
So you are. Yes. Yeah. So you're up for re-election, so you would need to go to caucus and be nominated. That's the simplest way if you want to run again. Otherwise, you have to go and get signatures, which you've been through before, you know that process. And the other one is Carl.
Carl.
So Carl will be up for only a two-year
Didn't you just get here?
Process. He did, but he was appointed, so he was never elected, he was a fill-in, so he'll...
I think he's taken a liking to the public service that he's undertaken, and I do believe he will be up for reelection.
So the best way would be if you and Carl went, you could nominate one another, and then you can both run that way.
What's the date again?
It's March 7th, and I don't know the time. It's usually in the 7 o'clock range.
Where is that held?
Town.
Town Hall.
Yes.
Okay.
The all-purpose room.
Yeah. So if it turns out one of you's not going, I'll go and nominate somebody if need be.
As long as it's after basketball practice. Just 5:45 to 6:47.
Yeah, I think it's usually 7:30, 8 o'clock, something like that. And that's all I have.
Who's coming off the selectmen, Jim?
I think it's John up this year, isn't it? I don't know for sure, but I think it's John. And I haven't heard of this person, whoever it is running again. I don't have any information. Okay, so have there been any collaborative meetings?
I did go to a collaborative meeting last week or the week before.
You skipped the budget.
I did? Who cares about the budget?
All right, fine with me.
Let's go back to...
No, go ahead.
Let's finish our reports and come back.
Finish your reports. Yeah, do your reports, yeah.
There was a meeting that the superintendents were invited to also. I assume Marty was at 50 other meetings that night.
Yes, I was.
They basically did a lot of review of the past year's accomplishments and I think to update
the... They had an annual report and you got to meet other people and I heard from different members that that was valuable for them.
Yeah, the superintendent from Greenfield was there. So it was good and they just talked about, you know, the stuff they do, which I've heard, you know, I'm well aware of it, but, you know, and rolled out their next, their continuing ed stuff or professional development stuff for the spring. And they're also in financial, pretty good financial shape at this point.
They are.
Yeah. So I think all was good. Mm-hmm. I should have brought their agenda, but there was nothing.
Thank you. So what do you think? Should we roll on to principal report or go back to budget?
No, keep going. save the budget for last.
Go ahead.
Well, we're awake and alert.
Yeah.
I'm still enjoying the chocolate.
Yeah, yeah.
Start with the building and grounds. We talked, I think, when Bob Lesko was here, we have one classroom, the OTPT room, that if we paint that, then Bruce can begin the cycle all over again. That's the last one. And he feels that he could do that during February break, and it can be covered in this year's budget. So that can be off the maintenance table. I just wanted to acknowledge that the town crews did an excellent job keeping the driveway and the parking areas open and clear. Buses could come in easily, and we're really grateful to them.
Can I add to that they were also, we had two buses that got stuck, and they were there immediately to help us get the buses unstuck. So thank you very much to the town Conway Highway Department.
My son's on the town crew now.
Oh,
is he?
The sun,
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
It's a cherished semi-annual tradition, the stucking of the bus.
Yes. The
on Roaring Brook Road.
They were particularly good on Monday.
Yeah. Ooh, that was a good one, Judy.
Yeah, now you just can't win for time.
Yeah. That snow was blinding.
Wasn't it blinding?
Blinding.
Please.
It took me an hour to get home. It wasn't like
it was bad going home. I felt somewhat vindicated.
The buses would have been well put away by then.
The problem, the problem is, as a district, we decided we would never do an early dismissal for snow, because especially what happens for the elementary level, parents aren't home or parents don't come to get them.
Yeah.
And so then the weather's bad, and children are stuck at school and teachers are stuck at school having to care for them, obviously. Yeah. So we decided we'd only do close or late start. So, but I know, I was just
But even the weathermen that day were like, it's coming, it's really coming. Like their timing was so off. They were like, it's snowing now in like Connecticut. And I'm like, oh my God, you guys are desperate.
Yeah. Right.
We had not a flake in Brattleboro until 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
I'm glad I wasn't in Brattleboro.
It's good to retire together.
Yeah.
Let it fly.
Some activity that you might be interested in. Yesterday, three sixth graders went to the Holyoke Soldiers Home with representatives from all the schools. We sent lots of Valentines. And I just wanted to note that the reactions of the kids really were, only three of them, but it was at one end, two girls were sort of delighted to go and to be of service and so forth. And then the one boy that was with them stopped and thought a little bit and said, you know what I thought? I thought that they're there all the time. Mm-hmm. And they don't get out a lot. He said, that's really what I thought about. Sort of a,
pretty reflective.
Reflective and a feeling. So we're happy to participate in that for sure. February 29th, Karen Green, she organizes a lot of events for parents across the district. She had a science night for dads and kids. We had 50 participants. It was pretty good for us.
Must have been January 29th.
I'm sorry. Yeah, January. She provided the dinner. And featured the mad scientist, and now you'll know why he's called the mad scientist. Although there was a small mishap involving an exploding volcano.
I'm afraid to ask the details of that.
I guess
it's a great sentence. Mishap and exploding volcano.
Yeah,
he did the volcano experiment in Deerfield, but their ceilings are a lot higher. So.
They are very high there, yes.
And they do so seem low here. When he did it in our cafeteria, the alarms went off.
Oh, that's funny.
And Bob Baker and company.
Oh, they all arrived? Oh, no.
Yeah, well, the fire alarms went off. They had to come. So they come into the cafeteria, look around, say, well, what are you doing?
Oh, that's so funny, Judy.
And the mad scientist apologized.
Yeah, that's a night to remember.
I bet the kids loved it.
They loved it because they knew exactly what to do when they heard that they all bolted. Yeah.
Left the mad scientist behind.
Holding the bag.
So anyway, it's sort of proof that all of our practices are good. They drag the adults with them right out of the building. It was really a nice event anyway. And the kids will remember it for a long time. And so will Karen.
Yeah.
We have a GCC nursing student with us. He's coming for 4 or 5 Thursdays, I think. This is our third year partner with Greenfield Community College, providing a space for practicum for nursing students. And Meg is really generous about spending time with them and introducing them to what it would be like to be a school nurse. So I'm glad to continue partnering with them. Also gives us access to additional nursing staff.
Right.
So it's a good deal for them and a good deal for us. I'm sitting like I sat this morning. This is a nice project that the Out of School Time program, Jody Massa, is doing. There are 4 sixth graders who will be leaving Conway who have been in the program for a long time. She calls them her seniors. And they always do some kind of project. This year they're collecting clean and dry trash that can't be recycled or composted. And they're making a bottle brick bench which will be large enough to put on the playground. The four kids visited all the classrooms, explained the project, and invited all of the classrooms to start collecting, you know, dry and usable recyclables for the project, which they're doing. It's sort of a nice way to celebrate the end of those kids' relationship with the out-of-school time program. So
it's really attractive, too. I mean, I saw the drawings of it.
Beautiful.
It's hard to visualize when Judy was explaining it to me. When I saw it, and I thought, this is great.
Yeah, what are they making it out of?
You take a 2-liter soda bottle, yeah, and you fill it with dry, recyclable, things that aren't recyclable.
Non-recyclable.
Yeah, but clean, yeah, clean and dry.
Yeah.
And they become like bricks.
And you just keep stuffing it down until...
Yeah. That's neat.
It is.
Very nice. School faculty, teachers, organize a walking running program to promote active lifestyles and exercise. This sort of just at an early stage. But staff and students are going to participate in walking, or walking with adult supervision during lunch and recess. The fourth and fifth grade teachers already marked an area that's about 1 mile for kids who want to do that during lunch. It's not competitive, it's just everyone does it for fun and exercise. And then on the 22nd, we're going to invite more people from the community to join the children. And I think they're going to try to do a 5-mile walk. So happy to bring everyone together to do that. Grades 1 and 2, first and second grade, had an evening event in which they reviewed some of the newer math programs. Mm-hmm. Pretty well attended for an evening in the winter. And Paulette ended the evening with a great read aloud about numbers. It was very nice. My last sort of bunch of stuff is about instructional assistants as they live here in this school. It is only intended for you to know the model that we use in this school, which may or may not be able to be replicated in other schools. I'm not promoting that or disparaging any other model. But I think that some of you heard from an IA at a larger meeting and heard sort of her interpretation of what her life is like in another school. And when I thought about, you know, what could I tell you that might be informative and helpful about how instructional assistants are used in this school, I thought I would like to do that and sort of leave the model as something that works here, and that whoever replaces me would probably be well advised to continue that model. So anyway, I have some bullets, and I'll just go through them quickly. I don't think most of them you probably already know. So here's what we do. Instructional assistants primarily work with children in small groups or individual kids. In reading and math, sometimes in writing, if there's an assignment, but primarily reading and math. So they're literally, they are doing instruction. They're often supervised, they're often practicing the instruction, but they're in that classroom. And their primary responsibility, unlike sort of years ago, is not to do bulletin boards or to correct spelling papers or whatever other things they used to do years ago. We really use them as instructors. We're very lucky in the building to have 4 certified teachers who are also classroom assistants. So the model works because of a lot of those variables also. Teachers prepare the materials that IAs will use when they're working with kids, so we don't expect them to do the prep. We do expect teachers to do it and to work with the IAs to be sure that they're implementing those plans, basically. IAs are able to meet with their teachers either early in the morning or during the prep period to talk about what they're doing. So luckily, we have enough prep time for teachers that they can at least once a week sit with their instructional assistant and answer questions or clarify things, hear how kids are doing with them. We're lucky in that way. With the exception of sixth grade, every classroom has an assistant. Every classroom has an assistant. Preschool has two this year because of the demographics of that room. An assistant's assignment does not change unless there's some change in the demographics of a particular room. So because we don't move people around, it's quite possible for one assistant to work in first or second grade or fourth, wherever they are, for a number of years. And we have people now who have been with second grade or first grade teacher for 5, 6, 7 years. So they really create a wonderful working partnership. And that's an important part of this model. I never understood or accepted the fact that they needed to be moved. Mm-hmm. If they were happy and the teacher was happy and they were productive and had good relationships with children of that age in that classroom, I was all for keeping them there. And I talked to them about that and they liked that a lot. They do monitor lunch and recess. And the one thing that we have added to that is that if an IA is having an issue at lunch or recess, and we really can't work it out in some way, they are free to ask me to ask a teacher, you know, would you come to the cafeteria at 12:30 and see what's going on, because I sort of can't get to the bottom of it. So we snuck that in there. And teachers are more than willing to do that. They're also more than willing to go outdoors if there's something that we can't resolve without their expert observations. IAs here may help with making copies, bulletin boards, but it's never their primary function. And in fact, if you came to the school, you would see teachers making their own copies more often than not. I think that should stay that way. IAs know their assignments before the start of the school year. So if I anticipate any change, before they leave for the summer, I say to them, there's a distinct possibility that I'll need you in kindergarten rather than in second grade. Rarely does that happen, but I think they should know in the summer where they're going. We have retained the custom of organizing a common morning break time for IAs. It just is a nice, so every teacher agrees that for 15 minutes in the morning, they're not going to have an IA because the IAs come down here and have coffee and chat. It's sort of a tiny, tiny thing to do, but in terms of morale, it's just an acknowledgement that they need that break and that it's good for them to be with their peers. You know, once a day. They don't always eat together because lunches are staggered. But this remains sort of inviolate. If you came in, you would see at 10:40, they're all coming down here, which I think makes sense and it's a good thing. A number of IAs have teaching certificates and they always have first dibs on tutoring during the summer. The child needs to be tutored and they're a certified teacher. We hire them to do the tutoring here in the summer. In short, they're vital members of the staff. They make solid contributions to the children. They're respected by their colleagues, by all of us. And for lots of reasons, the model fits our school. And I would encourage the principal that comes after me to really explore that model carefully. And if it needs to be tightened up or whatever at some point, but I think it's a model that works here. The IAs that work in this building, they don't have, they know, it's not, nothing is perfect for them, but they love it here. They really do. If they have to opt to go anywhere else, some of them would not go. So they're comfortable, they're valued, they really make a contribution to the school. We're lucky, I feel we're lucky to have them. I really do. And again, I'm not trying to ditch any other school that has a different model. This works for us. A small school works. Might not work in a larger school. I just wanted you to know that side of it.
Putting down a legacy. Mm-hmm. We like more of it, more of it. Can I just ask you, a lot of the concerns that I heard I forget her name. I mean, she did it on TV. You can talk about it. It's public record, but it doesn't even matter. But a lot of her concerns I thought were really applicable to two schools with multiple grades in each, and not really so applicable to the to Waitley and us.
And remember, I don't know if you were at the follow-up meeting, but an apology was given that those yeah. views represented her and only her, and the other IAs who were present at that particular meeting were upset because they didn't want her comments to represent anyone but her. So I need to put them in that context. So Judy's model here works very well here. It also works very well, very similar, not identical, but very similar to Waitley, which is another small school. It doesn't work as well in Deerfield and Sunderland because they would need so many more instructional assistants. So they unfortunately do not have an aide per classroom because they have three in every grade in Deerfield. So, but I agree. I think it works very well here, and I think it would be something that the next principal would want to try out before they change something.
So is that like a principal would attempt to reduce the number of IAs? Is that like the primary threat to the Judy legacy?
No, I think sometimes people think I'll give you an example in Sunderland. They have two or one class per grade, and they were finding that they were hiring an awful lot of instructional assistants dealing with special ed students, so that those IAs were dealing with a small population of students, and their budget kept rising and rising and rising. And so what they did, they didn't have a number of classroom assistants per classroom. So they would share. Let's say I had two first grades, so I'd have a first grade assistant who would go between the two classrooms. And that was all well and good. But again, you don't have the same level of contact that you have. And then sometimes they would go just during reading time or just during, so they were moving about because otherwise they'd have 30 or 40 instructional assistants, and that's expensive.
So I guess I'm not asking my question the right way.
So they float among different classes.
Yeah, based on the needs of the students. Where here, it's like a team, it's a partnership. You have one classroom per grade, you can form that partnership very nicely. And there, it's really based just on student need rather than a teacher and IA partnership.
So I think that, that this is great, the way we do it, it's the way I want it mm-hmm. to be. What are the signs that I should be looking for that it's not this way?
Well, you'll hear about it.
You'd hear about it, and if you saw some major budget reductions, and you asked why, that were where you see it immediately. But I think you would hear about it from people. If this is a model that works and people are pleased with it, if something were changed immediately, then I think people would not be pleased with it, and you'd hear about it.
They're unionized now, so it's
not
so easy to just clean house if you want to clean house. Which in this case is a good thing.
Okay. Thank you. Do you have a report, Heidi?
I do. I did. Did I hand it out? I did. And I also handed this out, and so I'll just tell you my little political speech right now. Which has to do with the governor wanting to lift the cap on charter schools. But I'd like to refer to this long Google size page just for a minute. One of my concerns, and concerns of many superintendents in this area, is the impact of charter and choice on a rural school district. So I wanted to bring you real dollars so that you can make sense of this. Patty put this together, and if you look at the first page, one of three, at the top you will see the schools, and then on the left you will see the towns. So if we look at Conway and just follow down, you have one student in Hatfield, one in Leverett, three in the Mohawk Trail system, two in Northampton, two in Sunderland. So you have nine who are choicing out for a variety of reasons. Look further, you have three at the Chinese Immersion School.
We have a bunch of Four Rivers and...
Well, but this is just elementary.
Oh.
Okay. If you look over...
Oh, I see.
Okay, do you see? So you have a total of 12 students who are out of school for either charter and choice. If you move over to the right and you look at the actual dollar figures attached to it, it's $111,444. And if you look at the other schools, you can see Deerfield spends $168, Frontier spends $979, Sunderland spends $40, and Whately spends $80. And what I need people to know is that when a charter school is supposed to have been formed, and I'm not opposed to charter schools, but when they were supposed to be formed, it was supposed to meet a need that didn't exist in the current education setting in that particular area. So for the Performing Arts School and the Chinese Immersion School, these are areas that we couldn't compete with. We are a college preparatory secondary school, and we have four elementary schools who feed into that system. And the state's promise when that all started was that we would be reimbursed 100% for the first year that that student left a school district. And that was to allow the schools to kind of learn how to deal with fewer students. And then for the next 5 years, they were supposed to get 25% of the cost to allow you to adjust the budgets. But very much like regional transportation, where you're supposed to get reimbursed 100%. If the revenues are not there for the state, they have said, well, we can only reimburse you 72% this year, or 60%, or 40%. I think last year was the highest and it was 80%. And that's what's happening with the state level. We have not gotten 100% reimbursement for the first year, and we've only gotten a portion of the 25% for the next 2 years. So it is so impactful on a school district like ours that has 3-to-1 students wanting to come to our school district as opposed to leaving our school district. And for the first year, for the first time next year, this year, Frontier, even though they have 127 students who choice into the district, has more revenue going out than they do coming in. And so I have sent this chart to Senator Rosenberg because he was looking for real information, real data. And my point is, if this is how a very good, desirable school system is affected like ours, how in the world is it affecting, if you look at Gil Montague and Greenfield on the next page, who are sending 103 and 107 students just to our district alone. And my fear, as I go out the door in my educational role, is that this is the beginning of the demise of public education. It may not have been the goal by establishing charter and choice.
It's the goal.
But they may not articulate it.
They articulate it.
This is going to be, I mean, this is where I got really crazy.
You haven't listened to Rush Limbaugh in a while if you think they don't articulate it.
I never listen to Rush Limbaugh.
You ought to. You ought to once in a while. Just once in a while.
It scares the heck out of me. So I'm letting people know because I think people can wrap themselves around this. You can actually look at this and go, Now, the difference you may see in some of the choice dollars, if you see a cost that's more than $5,000 and it's only one student, that is usually associated with a special ed differential.
Okay.
So that's why, in some cases, it's more than not, than less. So, anyway.
You should send this to the collaborative, because they're.
Yeah, I'm meeting with Bill tomorrow morning, okay. So I'm going to bring this to
him. I do hope that in the faculty meetings, in your faculty meetings, that you do this as well. That if
I don't have faculty meetings anymore.
Yes, you have to start going to them and do this, because if you can get the faculty to buy into that concept that it's under threat and let their instinct for self-preservation begin to kick in, there are actual numbers that they are exist in sufficient numbers in our towns to make a difference. Mm-hmm. And I would love to see them coming to town meeting.
Well,
and
I'm
standing up and saying what's right and what's wrong, and they don't.
So Elaine, on page 2 of 3, you'll see the Conway 7 through 12 that are going out. So you have six choice at the 7 through 12 and 10 charter. So altogether, there are 28 students from Conway choosing and chartering out.
And one thing I have been telling the other committees this as well, the figure that jumped out at me was the number of students that we have from our whole district going to Hatfield. We have 23 students going to Hatfield, which I thought was odd. I thought it was an anomaly. So I asked to have some data put together for who those students were and what grades they were leaving in. And what we found was that, yes, we are sending the town of Hatfield 169,000 or thereabouts for our students, for these 23 students. The students were leaving before they ever got to Frontier, because most of them are going out at the secondary level. They were leaving either immediately from the grammar school, they were leaving from a homeschool situation. And then I called the superintendent in Hatfield and asked, I know you don't have to tell me this information, but were parents reporting anything to you as to why they no longer wanted to have their students within district? And he said, well, I really don't want to tell you this, but what they were saying was that they were looking for a smaller school. And then many of them had siblings. So if an eighth grader, you know, went out and then they had a third grade sister, well, then they went too, for ease for parents. So, because I had said, if we are doing something.
You said, we're smaller now.
Yeah, I know. But if we're doing something that we can correct the image, correct the information, correct, we want to do that. And he said, not really. It was primarily people looking for smaller programs, because they only graduated about 35 students. So even though we have a higher variety of courses, especially on the secondary level, they were choosing it for its size. So I think there's a lot of good information here, and so I'm giving it to all the school committees. I'm, you know, talking to people about it to make people aware, because it's a huge, huge number. What the governor is proposing is a different funding reimbursement formula.
Yeah, that's what they say.
Right. And the problem is they're not fulfilling their obligation now, so why am I supposed to feel confident in anything else that's proposed? Go ahead, tell me you're going to give me 100% for 5 years. We're not going to get it.
Right.
So, anyway. And then I just talked briefly about what's been in the news about the bomb threats. There have been a number in the month of January. They've been primarily in the eastern part of the state. We did have 34 in Massachusetts. They've come through robocalls or emails. None have been real. There's been a lot of training and information going back and forth, and we continue to follow the state police guidelines. And so I contacted all the principals. The principals have worked with their secretaries. We have a protocol. It's on their desks. The closest one that I'm aware of was in Ludlow. And that's what I have.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now we start the budget at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
And I fell asleep about 10 minutes ago.
You want me to pass out the budget?
Jesus. You're making me laugh with you.
I'm not going to be able to make it to the next meeting.
The public hearing?
I'm not going to be here. So my trusty vice chair is going to have to take over.
Judy, do you want to keep that in your mind?
Not the vice chair, she's the chair of vice.
The chair of vice.
I'm going to be in Alabama.
Well, what are you going to Alabama for?
Visit my parents. They're down there for the winter.
The stars fall down upon Alabama. I love their license plate. I think it's the most beautiful license plate.
They're on at the Gulf Shore.
Yep.
Nice. So you'll come back tan.
Dalton.
If the weather cooperates.
The Dalton area.
Okay, so the last time we looked at our budget, we were at a 5.29% increase. And I'm sorry to tell you that we're up to a 5.31 increase, a difference of $308. And what the difference is we have finalized our central office expenditures. So even though you are decreasing in expenditure, we've had some increases in the expenses. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about that, and especially about our technology integration specialist. We had previously, when we proposed this, we allocated it evenly amongst the schools. And I know that this school committee in particular were not happy that that was an equitable allocation. So after having Maureen work most of this year, Scott and I sat down and we looked at her calendar, and although she does things district-wide, we did decide that the way we're going to allocate her salaries this year is based on the number of instructional teachers per school. So it'll be based on more like customers. So with that being said, last year you were assessed $9,917. This year the assessment would be $6,887. So that was a savings of $3,030.
That's great.
What was the feedback with that new position? Were the instructors liking it? Is this position useful?
Yes, very much so. Because it's somebody who knows technology but also can go into the classroom. And I think her use fluctuates, you know, from time to time, from building to building. Sometimes there's a huge clamor for her, you know, they're doing a project in a particular school and she'll spend a great deal of time there and nothing in another school, and then, you know, it'll shift. I don't know what your experience has been.
I think that's been our experience. That she's had a number of, she did a survey of what teachers were looking for, and then organized a bunch of lunch and learns, and she came here on a Friday, an early release, to work with teachers. And Suzico and I were chatting the other day, and she's been an enormous support for Sue. I mean, Sue has a lot of duties on her plate, and she has been an enormous support for her. So it's been working out well.
Yeah.
I think what's happening too is when we do the district-wide early release and she does a district-wide presentation, it sparks ideas for teachers, like, I didn't realize I could do that. So then her demand goes up because then they want some one-on-one attention. Mm-hmm. You know, so the teachers are really finding more applications to infuse that technology into their lessons, which I think really keeps our students engaged.
That's great. I'd like to hear that. And I would just like to remind everybody that that was our illustrious chairperson's idea.
The split it up more equitable, that
was
position
your...
wasn't my idea.
No. The idea to split it more equitably, yeah. The current budget reduction. I would just like to congratulate our chairperson, Presidente, for her wisdom in this regard.
So. When Jan speaks, the business manager listens.
That's right.
So, but on the other hand, our overall central office budget has increased. One, by the portion of the health insurance that gets assessed for the shared employees. And then we lost two grants, one of them being the kindergarten grant, which was paying for part of our early childhood coordinator salary. So that was increased. And also some of our financial staff was being charged to a grant, and under the new federal guidelines for grants, we can, unless you're working 100% on the grant, you can't be charged there. So we had to put those salaries back.
That's ridiculous.
Well, it's called Edgar.
Yeah.
So those costs did increase. So like I said, when the final allocation was done, yours changed by $308 from what we had originally assessed, and that's where we are with the budget. So at this point, we are just looking for feedback now if this is what you want to bring to the town floor, a 5.31% increase, or did you have any thoughts about what you would like us to do?
All of our budgets this year, I'm looking at as maintenance budgets. We really have no new initiatives. We have no new programs. We have no new hires. We're trying to maintain what we currently have, which is not razzle-dazzle, but all of our budgets are up because of all sorts of factors.
Wasn't there an issue where we could really use a few more notebooks or a few more whatever, that there was just that we were just at that point where we really just needed a few more?
I think, didn't we buy some from the end of year last year?
We did.
Yeah, I think.
Well, and that is one of the initiatives that we have.
Yeah, the 20,000.
Well, I don't want to say it's an initiative, because what we're trying to do is, now that we've been investing in the technology, Mr. Paul would like us to see, to have a maintenance of that technology. And so he was requesting $20,000 so that we can keep refreshing our servers and keep adding the Chrome, keep the leases going every 3 years. He and his team had done an extensive, inventory of all the technology in all the schools. And he feels that the total dollar divided by like the average life, we need $20,000 each year to do replacement and maintenance of the equipment. And that includes that's not just computers and servers, it's also
licenses.
Licenses, but what do you think?
Fires?
The ones
smart
that
boards.
Smart boards.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Smart
yeah,
boards.
See, that's a number that I would like a little bit more into. That's a kind of a big number for us, and it could include a lot of different stuff. And if it, you know, like, what is exactly maintenance? Is the breakage rate, like, how, is there something that we could be doing to reduce the, do you know what I mean?
It's like, not breakage, like, it's obsolescence. It becomes obsolete.
He does have a breakdown, though.
He
would
does.
You like
what number?
Yeah, I mean, like,
yeah.
What number is that?
If you look on the front, it's
yeah. Where is it in the actual?
Like for instance, Marty, you know, there's an issue about whether kids walk around with their, should be permitted to walk around with mm-hmm. their, or whether they should be carted, and you should be carting the things around.
At the school today, all have them and they carry them around.
But there's
really,
yeah, and they have very little breakage, very little theft, very little loss.
Except for 7th and 8th graders who have massive amounts of breakage.
Jan, if you look at the bottom of 4 of 12, that's where it starts. It says building technology, but the actual number is on the top of 5 of 12. It says other expenses, and it says 20,000.
So, what's the 4,700% increase? I don't understand that. That was one number I was going to ask about.
That could be a formula problem. It's an increase of 4,000, almost 5,000%, because it was 0 to 20 to 20 grand. But let me check my math in that little angle there.
But Scott Paul did put together a request for each of the buildings. And he has it broken down as to what that would entail. This is the only budget that we can actually even put it in. The other budgets we weren't able to even do that.
And I get, you know, would that include new?
Yeah. We will say.
Let me find out, because I don't want to say something and then regret it. So let me get more detail.
Every school deserves at least one thing that's shiny and new every year.
I know.
But Phil, if you're talking about bringing that up, something else has got to come down, because 5.31. That's a big jump, and I don't think that's going to be taken.
Well,
That's why I wanted to know what this number was, and whether that includes new equipment, as it sounds like it may. Mm-hmm. So that's.
And unfortunately, we had to remove that from every other budget.
Yeah.
because of the cost increase. And we may end up having to do
that. So not that I want to remove it, but what if you did? What does that bring that percent down to?
$20,000 in reduction.
Hang on, I can just take it out right here.
Yeah. I'm not saying I want to remove it. I'm just curious what that means.
Yes. Let me just find it here. Do you ever have one of those days where your mouse just won't roll?
I mean, I think we have to find some increase that we can hold.
This is also something that
we do, but I don't think it's technology. I mean, no. Technology.
That's
why
I'm looking at other stuff. Insurance, no.
Unfortunately, most of these are fixed costs.
Yeah.
You have insurance, you have your utilities, you have your personnel. You know, once the contract's negotiated, it might come down a little, but
it would bring it down to 4.15.
Mm-hmm. That's if you did nothing.
Right.
Patty, where's the building technology on our current budget?
We don't have any. That's what that. Oh, for
we have line items for
technology. Hang on, let me find it. I can't read this thing today.
There's no grants for technology.
There is, but when we did the cost benefit analysis, it was not worth it.
You had to put out more than
we could do it cheaper than what they how they wanted us to buy the materials.
How about district-wide information management? Yeah.
That's our Rediker system, our licensing fees for that, and SNAP, and Blackboard Connect, and all that kind of stuff.
So nothing that's manageable to drop?
No, it's your ASOP, it's all of your... Mm-hmm. Yeah,
here it is.
Yes. Hardware.
I don't see anything that you can...
So
that's the only thing that's...
I guess that's
touchable.
That's why it's that much more important to find out exactly what that is.
Yeah.
So Judy just did bring to my attention, and I'd have to discuss this with Scott. Under our other, we have been carrying $12,000 for new devices. I don't know if that means we can eliminate that $12,000 if we carry the full $20,000. I would think that it does mean that.
Where is that?
Under section 2453 on the top of page 7 of 12.
Yep. So that would probably bring us to somewhere around 4.6.
Yeah. I mean, that would be something to figure out. His recommendation for the $20,000 is in addition.
I understand it was in addition to the $12,000.
Well, so, if we did get rid of the $12,000, we would be at 4.61.
If we got rid of the 12 and kept the 20.
But that's only if the 20 sort of was intended to subsume what the 12 represents.
Correct. And that's the unknown right now.
I'm going to send Scott an email right now. This is what I love about bringing my computer, because I already texted Bob saying, what's going on with the leaks and the store costs? Because I don't have to run the good around.
Yeah. So I don't know. I'm kind of at a loss except for that stuff and what we can do about anything. Anyone else have any great ideas?
Well, I guess, Jan, do you have a number that you feel comfortable, and then Judy and Marty and I can go back and work on that? I mean, do you have a percentage that you're comfortable bringing forward?
I had asked Tom. I said, does the town have a percentage increase or percentage?
No one ever wants to set that limit. Because
and he didn't.
Right. You know, it's hard to say that when they don't have the body of the budget.
Right.
I'm fine with 5. I know they're tickled pink at 3. 4, they're 5. It's almost 4. I'm good.
Yeah.
All right. Well, why don't we do this?
Because always, you know, it depends on the mood of the people.
Right. Are there any other large projects going on in town? this year that would buy?
There's not large projects, but...
There's a desire for large projects.
There's a very, very limited amount of free cash. I should have this number on the top of my head, but I think it's around only $160,000 this year for Conway.
That is low. That's very low.
But that means you did a good job budgeting your revenues.
It does, but it also...
Assessing our community.
It doesn't give us anything extra to work with.
Right.
So all of this stabilization money has to come from somewhere.
Okay.
And so we have garage stabilization, we have general stabilization, school
right.
stabilization, ambulance stabilization, fire, you know.
Okay.
So all of that has to come from somewhere. And this year we could possibly have to raise some of that through taxation. So,
okay.
you know, that along with the increase in everyone's budget is hard to swallow for people. It means a very big jump in their taxes. It means our levy
right.
limit is like getting closer.
Right.
Conway has always had a pretty big gap, lots of room.
Frontier's increase is relatively small, isn't it, for Conway?
Percentage? Yes.
What?
No. They're on the larger side.
Yeah.
They're on
You're
there.
On the larger side. Okay. All
yeah.
right.
They're
in
like
down
10%.
10.
Yeah.
Yeah. Conway's portion?
Mm-hmm. Oh, the grammar school looks good then.
it's Conway's year under the 5-year rolling thing.
Oh.
It's our year.
Oh,
remember 5 years ago it was
yeah,
the 12% budget?
Yeah.
That was it's the year that every 5 years you go under our
right.
formula. There's
Yeah, Sunderland and Whately are the winners, Conway and Deerfield are not. All right, I was trying to give you some good.
I just don't see where we can go with this, you know, other than cutting positions, and that's definitely not something we want to consider at this point. So.
And then maybe, like, you know, what are our priorities if we, you know, if push comes to shove, what are our priorities? Is the stabilization the first to let go that you let go of, or is part? You know, do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, what's the priorities? So that's like,
yeah.
is that the next step?
Rather let go of stabilization than technology.
True.
Yeah.
Absolutely, that's true.
Okay.
But that doesn't solve any problems for you because I don't think that's a fair trade. Stabilization money for budget.
Yeah. Present for future.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable with a 4%? You know, 4.3, something like that.
I think somehow it sounds better.
It does. It's like $9.99 as opposed to $10.
All right.
I know.
Yeah, so if that $12,000 was in addition, that's really great.
That would be the answer,
and
actually.
Maybe,
yeah.
And then, you
that
know, if we need to go any further, maybe we can go from 20 down to 15.
Well, let's see what the 20
is. Yeah,
let's see what the 20
what
is.
The details are, okay.
But that's what we can explore.
And how about this? How about if I email you the details ahead of time, all right, so that you have them before the, especially you won't be there.
Public hearing,
yeah.
yeah. We don't vote that night, right?
Yes, you do.
We do vote that night.
Yep. So we can always
you're the voice of you're the voice of financial sanity.
Email. We need to email the committee members the details for the 20,000 and what he anticipates coming out of the 12.
Yeah, I'm just afraid. Yeah, because I know right in the 12 could be we've been buying devices, but I'm not sure if we've been leasing them here or not, which means we'd have a second
if we have
third
a lease
year,
agreement already, then
we'd
we
have second and third
that.
Year payments.
Right.
And I don't know if he's including that in this 20.
I think we should plan to do a video conference for the
budget
and vote the budget by iPhone.
You can handle it without me.
There you go.
But
no,
so
you're the fiscal conservative.
I really struggled over picking that date. I did, but it had to be.
You're the fiscal conservative.
What are the other towns about the same?
Oh, no. Yeah. Sunderland's over 10.
That would make
The budgets are all over the place. This is actually pretty low. What was Whately for tonight? Whately was 3 or 4. What was Whately's padding that we just dropped tonight? Whately's budget. I just
percent
increase. Yeah, percent. Oh, it's right here. 4.56. Sunderland is 10 something. Deerfield's 3 something. Mm-hmm. 3, 5, 6, I think. So you're right in the
mix.
Yeah,
so, we just want to email the details from Scott. We're not looking for any certain percentage cut at this point.
Well, we may. We're going to email them to them, and we may need to do what we decided to do tonight for Whately, is set a 6 o'clock meeting prior to the public hearing.
But Jean's not here.
That's fine.
I know, but hopefully Ken or Carl,
Carl and I,
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
We'll be here, so that if we need to have a discussion about it, we can do so before we open it.
And you can always email us your feelings before your before you leave.
Mm-hmm. You, not them.
Yes.
All right, so is that okay with you? The next
yes.
meeting, we do it at 6? 6 p.m.?
I think we should set a goal to, and I hate to do this, but I think we should try and bring it under 5%.
Okay.
What do you guys think that's reasonable?
I think under 5 is reasonable. I don't think that we should go like to 4 or whatever unless it's something we can do.
So 4.99 would be okay?
4.99.
Okay. So why don't we look at
depending on how the contracts come
look
in.
We'll work at those things. We'll look at those things. We'll talk with Judy. We'll talk with Scott. And
from what I hear, though, I mean, it sounds like a very real thing that if the two things really are on there and they stand for each other, that we could let go of one and not affect anything, and the numbers would be good and all.
Well, you know, at some point in my mind, and that's what I was just saying to Judy, at some point, our textbook line should be being reduced because we're not really buying texts anymore.
That's a good point.
No, but you're buying software now instead.
Right, but we've got a software budget. So when does that textbook line start going away?
Right.
Now.
Or reducing.
Now?
I think when it stops when we stop worrying about new math programs and new writing programs and
right.
reading programs.
Right, because right now we are buying materials for new curriculum. You're correct.
So if those programs stay in place, then that line item should come.
Now, do we have budgeted a superintendent's salary and a principal's salary that are...
I have made the adjustment in the central office budget to what the posting said. At the high end. I don't know what the posting said for Conway, so if we want to make that, do you know what the range was?
I do, and our budget should be fine.
Okay. Yeah, Judy's on the high end.
But will we have that actual number before our budget's finalized?
No, because you won't have negotiated a contract by then with a new principal.
How long does that take?
Well, one of
you
get
a higher
decision.
One.
You have to hire one first.
Right.
And then
It's the lawyers that take the time to
you'll
sit on it.
You'll have your decision probably with the first.
With a superintendent, you'll have hired by then, but you won't have a principal hired by then.
Mid-March, I'm thinking, right? April?
What's the cutoff? I don't know for the.
February 19th.
Well, don't forget, their town meeting is not till May.
We'll be giving you a finalist by, I think it's March 3rd.
So because
when's our hearing? March?
Not a finalist, the finalist.
The finalist.
I think our hearing is March 17th. I think we're here on St. Patrick's Day.
If I'm getting
really
it March 3rd,
well,
then definitely we'll have a...
Well, then you'll have to do your interview, right?
Yes.
And then make your decision.
Yeah,
and
I have to go
and negotiate
check,
the salary.
Check
so
the
take another week or two.
Yeah.
It'll be close.
Get the salary down there.
So next meeting, we're going to have a new superintendent and a new principal named.
It'll be close.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, close. Yes, for superintendent.
Maybe
close
for
But even if principal. We voted at the hearing, doesn't mean we can't reduce it after, before we go to the town hall, with the actual number.
That's
town
true.
Meeting, you mean? Yeah,
because
yeah.
their meeting's not till May.
Right.
So we can always
right.
amend it in April.
We don't meet with the select board until April.
Right.
Is that right?
I don't know. I haven't received
an invitation.
No one's
asked us to come yet.
Yeah. I haven't heard from your finance or select board yet. Although I keep pretty close contact with Tom, so.
I talked to one the other day after basketball and just was asking about our meeting tonight. He said he might send somebody, but
Usually we don't have too many, well, obviously in Sunderland, we had everybody last night because the figure is so high. But typically we don't have...
It was in the papers?
We invited them. We specifically invited the select board and finance people because it's such a high figure.
Is it special ed?
No, it's to meet net school spending.
They spend under the required minimum contribution, so we had to bring it up. So, but typically we don't have finance and select board until March.
I was asked twice by our chair of the finance committee, twice in the past week, do we have a budget yet and when can I get something to him?
Tom emails me every Monday. I tell him general percentages.
Do you want us to send him this budget or do you want to wait till March?
Wait.
Okay.
I think we need more clarification on technology, so.
Are we meeting, is our next meeting St. Patrick's Day?
I think so, yeah.
God, that's a national holiday, isn't it for us?
Well, in Holyoke it is.
God, that's bad planning.
It is bad planning, isn't it? Really, I didn't know that.
That'll have to be the night to go to the Conway.
You know what? I will do that.
All right, there you go.
No. Oh, you won't be there.
See all the fun you're going to miss?
Yes, yes. You'll have to come again for Jan.
Yeah, because what are they going to do at this point?
Jan, you said you were going to have us up to your front porch in like May.
I did?
Nice.
Okay.
I forgot about that.
Sure.
It's a pretty porch.
That'd be nice.
No, but I will go to the Conway on March 17th. Make sure I have a late start on.
That's right.
Okay.
All right. Oh, back to my duties.
Adjourn.
She motions to adjourn.
Okay. 8:26.
All in favor?
Aye. This is great, though.